G'day, it's your old mate Prezzo here back in the shop, and today I'm working on what I hope is the fifth and final episode in the re-engineering of this pull gear. Now, pull gear is an accessory for a drill press or a small lathe. It uses a planetary gearbox built into the inside of this casting, and it gives you roughly a 4-to-1 reduction in the spindle speed. It also gives you an increase in torque, which is the thing that I was looking for in my drill press. Now, if you're interested in building one of these, there are four previous episodes which show the design of this pull gear from scratch, and there's a link in the description below, and I'll put a card up here as well if you're interested in having a look at those. I originally saw this design on a video by Mr. Pete, or Tubal Cane, and he did a teardown, refurbishment and rebuild of one of the original units. This one is a reverse engineered version of that. I've also made available the 2D drawings and the 3D model of this device, and you'll also find a link in the description below if you want to download those and have a go at making one yourself. And I'm really keen to see what other people can do with this. I'd love to see one which incorporates some sort of built-in lubrication system or uses a V-pulley here instead of a poly-V pulley, which I've got. And, you know, it's interesting to see what other people can do when they run with the idea. Now, to finish off this device, what I need to do is to find some way of keeping this top cap stationary while the spindle inside is driven. And on the original pull gear, that was done by inserting a steel rod into a hole in the cap, and it was locked in there to give you the low speed drive. And if you want to run it in 1-to-1 or direct drive mode, you withdraw that pin and lock the spindle to the cap with this latch. Now, everybody's drill press is going to be different, and they're all going to require some different sort of system to anchor that rod and allow it to be withdrawn and locked and so on. So the mechanism I want to build to fit to the top of the drill press is based around this fabricated steel bracket. It's 32 millimeters wide, it's 12 millimeters thick, and this pair of holes is matched to a pair of holes that exist in the top of the drill press already. They were originally to mount the intermediate pulley system, which was missing when I bought my drill press, and that's basically why I need a pull gear in the first place. This milled slot in the vertical section here gives me 10 millimeters of adjustment in the vertical plane, and this is just to eliminate any need to fit that whole position when I assemble the bracket. Now, I did think about hot bending this bracket. At the end, I decided to weld it together. And I was going to make a joke here, but instead I'm just going to show you my weld. Yep, and I say weld, and I mean it very loosely. It's more like a sort of a fabrication based on a very porous and a very slaggy sort of weld. Look. I'm not a welder, okay? And that's the best I could do. I've really got to get some gas at that bloody welder. Now, the other components that I'll need to finish this build are a piece of mild steel. This is going to become part of a detent mechanism. The detent is going to allow the steel pin to either be inserted into the hole in the cap where it will lock, or to withdraw that safe distance so that it won't interfere with the rotation of the pull gear. And this is just a nifty little ball. It's going to be fitted to the end of this rod just so I can get a grip on that. Just before we do that, I want to address a problem that's cropped up in the comments in my channel. This is a comment from a different video that I did, and it's from a gentleman named Mr. Sado Drive. And Mr. Drive says, and I quote, "I've lost 5 minutes and you just talking. Where do you want to go? Do the work and leave too many words." Yeah, well, I get that. Some people don't like me talking about what I'm doing. I came from a background in education, and the technique that I used was I would show students a process and I would discuss it as I went. And, I know some people don't like that. They just like to watch the work being done and judge for themselves whether it's worthy or not. So the important thing is that I've learned from that, I'm going to move forward, and I'm going to do this build, and I'm not going to talk about it much. And As far as Mr. Drive goes, I bear him no malice, and why should I? Okay, so let's head over to the lathe and start work on this detent mechanism. And, oh, sorry, I forgot. Just do the work and shut up. So I'm all set up here.
Shut up!
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, here are all the major components of the pull gear locking mechanism and...
Shut up.
No, you shut up. I'm trying to build a pull gear here. God, I bet Mr. Pete doesn't have to put up with this. All right, deep breath. Let's just move on and try and ignore him, shall we? So the bracket, you can see, has been powder-coated. That's ready to go on the machine. The locking pin itself is made from a piece of 10mm stainless steel. Why stainless steel? I just had some, that's all. In the back of the spindle, or the spindle locking pin, there is a 3mm wide or 1/8 inch wide groove cut with a Woodruff cutter. And the purpose of that is to keep that spindle aligned in this bushing. And the reason for that is that I put a spring-loaded detent in the bushing to keep the locking pin either fully engaged or fully removed from the cap of the pull gear. Now, if you are interested in learning about spring detents, there's an excellent video by this old Tony, and I'll put a card up there if you want to check that out. He goes into a lot more detail about how they're made, why they're used, and so on, so I won't bother repeating that here. You can just see the ball protruding through into the bore of that bush, and that's held in place by a grub screw and a spring, so that when the dimple in the back of the pin engages in that or engages on that ball, it'll hold it firmly in place. You should be able to see the spindle locking in place there with the ball detent. And if I push it in far enough, it locks again in that position. And if for some reason it was sort of halfway in between, the pressure of the ball and the spring will stop that spindle from rattling backwards and forwards. Now, to keep the dimples aligned with the ball, there's an 8mm grub screw with a 3mm pin machined on the end of it. You would have seen that in the machining video. And that can be inserted into the back of the bush. And when I assemble this for good, I'm going to put some thread lock on that just to make sure it doesn't come loose in service. And the other good thing about that grub screw is that it stops you removing the spindle completely. So that if you have a look, there's the groove, where is it? The groove there stops just short at the end, so that you can't physically remove the pin and lose it. Now, there's just a 16mm nut to keep that engaged on the bracket, and I've fitted a fiber washer there just to protect the powder coat on that bracket. The bushing itself has been chemically blackened, and I find that the Caswell product that I've been using for this is very good. It activates very quickly. It seems to hold the color for quite a long time. It does reduce the tendency for the steel to rust. So let's go and get this bracket installed and get the whole pull gear mechanism working and give it a bit of a test run. Oh, what's this here for? Oh, that's to protect the powder coat, of course. You want me to take it off? Okay. There, happy now? Now you can sort of see why I need that slot in the bracket. I couldn't be absolutely sure about the final position of the pull gear on the motor shaft. And what I've done is I've gone through and I've aligned the three-step pulleys at this end with the three-step pulleys at the spindle end. And once I was happy with that, I locked off the grub screw underneath the pull gear. So with everything aligned there now and the pin inserted into that fixing hole, I can go ahead and lock that nut. All Okay, so that shows the pull gear mechanism rotating now. Line it up in the correct place, pins inserted, and that's all locked now. And you may recall from one of my previous videos, I had all sorts of drama getting this latch to drop in. Well, that's now fixed, and it locks in and pulls down under its own spring pressure, so that once that latch is fitted into the slot, you must be sure to remove the locking pin. And then it operates in normal one-to-one direct drive mode. So to activate the low speed or reduction drive, you have to lift the latch out, rotate it through 90 degrees, and it's now free to rotate. The spindle is free to rotate, and through the gearing mechanism inside the cap, it's going to drive the bottom half of the pulley assembly. So that's basically operating in the reduction speed mode there now. So we're going to get the belt on and give it a real world test. Okay, belt's on, it's tensioned, and let's run it first of all in its direct drive mode. Okay, this is a 13mm drill bit. I've got a piece of half inch thick mild steel clamped down to the bed of the drill press. My drilling machine, before I did any modifications on it, at 50 cycles a second would give me 870 RPM at the spindle using the second step pulley. That's the second lowest direct drive speed that I could have got with this machine. Now, 870 RPM is really way too fast for a drill bit this size. You'd want to be comfortably working at something like half that. I'll just show you what 870 RPM looks like. And although I get plenty of torque at that speed, the drill speed is basically too high, and you're going to burn the drill bit or damage it. So let's turn it down to about half that. So that's going to give us roughly, 400 RPM. So we'll go down 25 Hertz. Okay, so this is about 400 RPM. Let's just see what happens. Okay, and that noise you can hear is not the belt slipping, that's actually the motor just stalling out. So I've been through all the settings on my variable frequency drive, and I've optimized it to give me the most amount of torque at low speeds, and it's really not helping. So as it turned out, if I wanted to drill, you know, anything like a 13mm hole or a half inch hole in mild steel without a pilot drill, I was basically wasting my time. I can pilot drill it and I can get through, but you know, you've got to use two or three different size pilot drills to get any sort of effective cutting torque with this larger drill bit. Now let's engage the pull gear and just see what a difference it makes. Okay, pull gear is engaged. I've got the same pulley set up using the same set of pulleys, and with the roughly 4-to-1 reduction now, I should be getting about 200 RPM at the drill bit. So let's just see what that sounds like. Okay, a little bit grindy, but it's not too bad. But let's just have a look at what a difference it makes with the cutting torque. All right. There was a slight slipping in the belt when I really leaned on that the handle to make that cut, but certainly it's cutting well. You know, it's removing chips, which is all I want. And remember, that's a 13mm drill bit with no pilot drill. So under normal circumstances, you would pilot drill that, you know, maybe 3 or 4 millimeters, and then that clears the web of the drill point, and then you're going to get full cutting action on the cutting edges. But I think that demonstrates that I've got way more torque than I was ever going to get using the VFD or any combination of pulleys. So let's just speed that up a bit, and you know, I can speed it up, still keep the torque, and I'm not going to burn the drill bit, and I'm going to get more cutting happening in a short period of time. Okay, so I'm happy with that. Once again, it's removing decent chips. Let's try it with a bigger drill bit. Okay, this is a 20mm drill bit. The pilot hole that I've got drilled in there is around about 11mm. Okay, I could feel that drill bit slowing down. I'm not sure whether that was motor slippage or belt slippage, but certainly I could speed that up a bit to give me a little bit more torque. But you know, once again, I'm pretty happy with a 20mm drill bit. There's no way in the world I would have got that to cut before. So it could be a limitation too on the motor size that I've got. I think that motor is a three-phase 0.75 kilowatt. Maybe I should have gone for like a 1 kilowatt motor, but all in all, I'm pretty happy with it. You know, it's going to take a bit of time to experiment with it and work out its limitations, but just based on that, it seems to be working fine. Okay, now I did say right back at the start of this video that it was the last part, and that's true. It is the last part of the pull gear and the build of the pull gear and testing it. However, I still have to modify this cover so that it will close down and keep the pull gear enclosed and the belt. So that's going to mean a little bit of sheet metal work and some welding and painting and so on. And that's going to be the next video that I do. So just pretend for a moment it's got nothing to do with the pull gear. We're just going to have some fun with some sheet metal work. And to get myself prepared, I've watched every episode of Project Binky that I can find. And if you're interested in sheet metal work and welding and fabrication and motorsport, check those guys out. They're a laugh a minute, and they really know what they're doing. Just in winding up, I'd like to thank Mr. Pete. He's helped to increase the number of subscribers I have to this channel. And I'd like also to thank all those people who've left comments and encouraged me to keep going forward with this project. Without that, you know, you sort of lose heart occasionally when things don't go well. And you sort of feel obliged that you've got to make the thing go at the end. So thank you to all the new subscribers, everybody who's left a comment. It's great. So I'm going to wind this up here, and we'll see you on the next video. Thanks for watching.